Thank you very much. It's very much a pleasure to be here, and thank you very much to the organizers for a really very, very nice conference. I've been having a great time. Okay, so as Jordan pointed out earlier today, we all sort of, you know, had these secret email meetings that we were all going to talk about braids. So I'm going to talk about braids. And I guess the sort of subtitle of my talk, is that the right word? Anyway, it's the thing that goes underneath the title, is basically how embedded surfaces in the four-ball can give you information about braids as mapping classes. So let me tell you a little bit first. Well, let me remind you what a braid is. Of course, we all know at this point because we've heard Jordan's talk this morning, plus a bunch of other talks about braids. But let me tell you how I think about braids. So first of all, we fix a disk with n points on it. And it's often convenient for these endpoints to be along. Think of this disk as being like the complex unit disk, and these endpoints being along the real axis. And let's give the set of endpoints a name, P. Okay, well, now you can thicken up this disk. So look at, let's call this disk DN, where N stands for the number of points. And you can thicken up this disk. And now a braid will just be a tangle in dn cross I, where the endpoints of the tangle are constrained to lie at this at these points p at the top and the bottom. And also you want the property that every slice, if you intersect this braid at any slice of this thickened disk, this tangle at any slice of the thickened disk, so dn cross t, it's always n points. Okay, and of course, and this is considered up to isotopy through such objects, so keeping the top and the bottom fixed as you do with tangles typically. And of course, the reason why low-dimensional topologists like braids is because we like links, and you can get from any braid to a link by taking its closure. So that's just the process of joining the top and the bottom. And this closure naturally, well, usually we like to think of it as lying in S3, but actually this closure naturally lies inside of a solid torus, which is embedded in S3 in a natural way. So this is inside of dn cross S1, which is in S3. So if you have your braid here, then this is what we'd call a closed braid. Okay, great. But now also, it's very nice to think of braids as mapping classes. So you can really think of the braid group. So you can think of N braids as really orientation preserving diffeomorphisms of this disk that fix the boundary pointwise, so fixed pointwise. This set of points P setwise modulo isotopies that fix both the boundary and the points pointwise. So isotopies fixing everything pointwise. And from this point of view, So of course we know from this point of view what sort of 5-year-olds who braid hair know, which is these types of diffeomorphisms are actually generated by taking any pair of adjacent strands and sorry, I'm sort of getting ahead of myself. So this the set of diffeomorphisms up to isotopy, are really generated by taking any pair of adjacent points, thinking of the arc connecting them, taking a regular neighborhood of that arc connecting them, and then rotating by a half twist, either counterclockwise or clockwise. So, so these are the standard Artin generators of the braid group. So let's call sigma I for the counterclockwise twist around exchanging the ith and the I plus first point. Okay. All right, and then in terms of this tangle description, if I draw my braid from left to right instead of top to bottom, this is just all right. Okay, so now the second thing that I mentioned in the title of my talk is complex geometry. So how do braids arise naturally in complex geometry? Well, we heard from Jordan the sort of simplest way that braids arise in complex geometry by looking at spaces of square-free complex polynomials in a single variable. But they also actually arise quite naturally when you're looking at complex polynomials in two variables. So let me tell you how this happens. Okay, so let's start with a complex polynomial in two variables. So this is kind of an old story. So if you start with a complex polynomial in two variables, well, of course, what we are always dying to do is look at its vanishing set. So this is just the set of points in C2. Where this polynomial vanishes. And since we sort of understand the one variable case very well, it's very natural to maybe try to separate out the variables. So let's collect like terms in W. Okay, so let's write F as, say, some polynomial in Z times W to the N times plus some polynomial in Z times W to the N minus 1, etc. Okay. And now if you put some mild restrictions on F, I won't enumerate them. Let me just do this. So with mild restrictions on F, if you look at the set of so now you could imagine plugging in some value for Z and then looking at what all of the values are that you can plug in for W so that the polynomial vanishes. So say fix some value of Z. So now if you look at the set B, this sort of set of complex number Z naught, such that when you look at the polynomial with that value of Z, so F of Z naught W has fewer than n roots in W. So you sort of expect in general if you plug in some value for Z, some particular value for Z, well, you have some degree n polynomial in W. And so you'd expect to see n roots, as long as you sort of stay away from some bad situations. This now is some subset of C. So let's think of C2 here just because we're going to be restricting to certain values of z and certain values of w, let's sort of mark them. So this is a finite set. And so what this is telling you is that now let's look at the CZ plane. So we're just kind of looking at certain values of z. There are certain sort of bad points where if you now let w vary, so now if you look at there are certain bad values of z for which the function restricted to that value of z has fewer than n roots, but everywhere else you're fine. So what that's telling you now is that if you take some loop, let's call it gamma, inside of cz minus b, then what that's telling you is that over every one of these points you have n values of w for which this equation vanishes. So what we're saying is that the intersection of this vanishing set with gamma cross cw, so this other copy of c corresponding to the value w, is actually a closed braid, and it's an n braid. So is a closed n braid. And in fact, this closed n braid is naturally really living in a solid torus, because everything is actually compact here. So all of the values of w that work are sort of sitting inside some large enough ball. And in fact, if you think a little bit harder, so actually you can replace this cw with some large, some disk of large radius. And so now actually really what you have is a closed braid inside a solid torus, but also inside of a piecewise smooth embedding of S3 into B4. So you really have this bi-disk. So you have this bi-disk, say D gamma, which is the, let me, so here's CZ, here's CW, and in here you have this curve gamma, and then it bounds some disk D gamma, and in CW you have this sort of sufficiently large disk DR, and it's bounded by its boundary. So you have this bi-disk D gamma cross DR. And its boundary is a piecewise smooth embedding of S3 into B4. And in fact, it's giving a natural genus 1 Haygarth decomposition of that S3 as well. So this boundary is a piecewise smooth embedding of S3 into B4. And in fact, it's really giving a genus 1 Haygarth decomposition as well. Haygarth decomposition. So really realizing S3 is the union of two solid tori. So you've got this closed braid sitting inside of one of the two solid tori inside a genus 1 Haygarth decomposition of S3. Okay. So this is kind of an old story. This construction has been known for quite a while. But what's really interesting, so of course the first natural question to ask, this is a very natural construction of closed braids. Can you get all closed braids this way? And the answer is quite certainly no, quite decidedly no. And in fact, there's a very nice characterization of which closed braids do arise this way by Lee Rudolph. So it's a theorem of Lee Rudolph that the braids that arise via this construction are precisely the braids that he calls quasi-positive, and they have a very nice characterization in terms of their associated mapping class. So let me tell you, so topologists, we topologists love it when people prove a theorem like this, because if you can get some nice topological characterization of something which involves involves geometry, then that's always really helpful. It in a way that I'll try to make clear also throughout the talk. So via this construction are the quasi-positive ones, and I'll tell you what I mean by quasi-positive braids. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. So let me tell you what quasi-positive braids are and why they're nice. So here are quasi-positive braids. So we probably know, or we can easily say what we mean by positive braids. So positive braids are just ones that can be written entirely with respect to these elementary Artin generators in terms of positive twists. Okay, so now quasi-positive braids are ones that, so quasi-positive braids, which I might abbreviate to QP, are ones that can be written entirely as products of arbitrary conjugates of elementary Artin generators. So we can always write it as some sort of product of a finite number of arbitrary conjugates of these elementary Artin generators. Okay, so this is some algebraic description, but actually what's nicer is the topological description. So remember I said at the beginning that if you have a positive Artin generator, you can really think of it as being in terms of the associated mapping class, this diffeomorphism sending the points to themselves as a counterclockwise rotation around about a regular neighborhood of one of these simple arcs connecting the ith to the ith plus first. So this is a positive generator. Well, if you think about what a quasi-positive generator is, so by a quasi-positive generator, I just mean a conjugate, an arbitrary conjugate of a positive Artin generator. A quasi-positive generator if you think about taking this simple arc connecting the ith to the I plus first strand. Let's call this simple arc, say, Pi. And now imagine, let's call it, say, Pij. And now let's think about what a conjugate of it looks like. Well, if you, for example, look at the image of that original arc, Pij, under, so I want to read my braids from the left to the right, so I want them to act on the right. Under the inverse of this conjugating braid. Okay, so now let's think about what's going to happen here. If we now act by omega j times this stuff, yeah, this conjugate of our original elementary art and generator, well, what's going to happen? Well, the first thing that's going to happen is it's going to take this arc back to this simple arc. And then you're going to do that counterclockwise rotation, and then you're going to go back to where you were. So the end of all that is that what's really happening is that you're taking, again, now some counterclockwise, this counterclockwise half twist about an arbitrary arc. So not just these simple ones, but an arbitrary arc connecting two points of P. Okay, so one of these quasi-positive braids is a product of counterclockwise, or you could call them positive, half twists around arbitrary arcs connecting pairs of points. Okay, so that's a very, very nice topological characterization. But it's actually, so I don't know how many of you have worked much with the braid group, but I mean we have this very nice presentation of the braid group due to Artin. But it's actually very difficult in general if I hand you a braid and ask you, is this braid quasi-positive? Well, it may not be obviously quasi-positive, but it might still be. It's an interesting question that was asked by Lee Rudolph, how to characterize conjugacy classes of quasi-positive braids. Or more generally, how to characterize when a link is quasi-positive.
Sorry, but can you give examples of something
that is not quasi-positive? For example, the negative, the left-handed trefoil, for example. There are obstructions to quasi-positivity that are coming from contact geometry, for example. I'll talk about some obstructions to quasi-positivity. Okay, so let's now talk about some obstructions to quasi-positivity. And this is where, this is actually where surfaces in the four ball come in, and also where some of the, some of the big hammers from, for example, gauge theory and homology-type invariants are gonna come in as well. Okay, so here's a theorem. So really the big part of this is what was proved by Kronheimer and Rufka. But Lee Rudolph was able to extend what they proved using the sort of topology of quasi-positive braids and how it interacted with complex geometry to prove the following theorem. Okay, so let's let beta be a quasi-positive braid with writhe n. Sorry, with writhe. So let's let beta be an n braid, and let's let its writhe be denoted by w. So let's think about what we mean here. So the writhe, of course, of a braid is just the number of positive elementary Artin generators minus the number of negative Artin generators in the word. And so if we're talking about a quasi-positive braid, well, it's just conjugates of these positive elementary Artin generators. So the writhe is just the number of those quasi-positive generators you have. Yes, yeah, right, yeah. Say it again.
So as a stupid obstruction.
Yes, of course, yes. That's a nice stupid obstruction, but it's a good one, yeah. Then what do we know? Then the closure of beta bounds a ribbon embedded, and I'll explain what this means in a second. Surface in the four ball of Euler characteristic exactly n minus w. And in fact, this surface is minimal complexity among such surfaces. So I'll say what I mean by that. And this surface is minimal complexity. Among embedded surfaces bounded by this braid closure. Okay, so I should say what I mean by minimal complexity. If the braid closure is a knot, then we know what we should mean by minimal complexity. It's just minimal genus. If it's a link, you have to say a few more words. So you want to look at embedded surfaces oriented. You want to look at embedded surfaces with no closed components for which the orientation matches the braid-like orientation. So I didn't explain ribbon embedded yet. So of course, what we know what we mean by a smoothly embedded surface. I guess I didn't say smoothly, but everything that I'm talking about is smooth. So ribbon embedded. So if you now look at there's this radial function on the four ball, and up to isotopy, when you restrict that radial function to a surface, it can be made to induce a Morse function on the surface, and what you want is that for it to be ribbon embedded, that Morse function has no critical points of index 2. So what that means for us topologists is that in any movie of the surface, so you can sort of visualize the surface by taking slices of it, and these will generically be links or singularized links. And what you want is that you never have to introduce new components in that movie. So you only ever have to do saddle moves and get rid of discs by so you don't have any caps. You only have saddles and cups. From the outside in, yes. All right, okay. Okay, so this is the wonderful result. So I'm going to, so most of the rest of my talk will be trying to explain how we should understand this result. And the idea here is that so what this is giving is somehow some obstruction to quasi-positivity of braids, and this really is a topological observation that I'll explain along with some gauge theory. But I'm going to try to replace the gauge theory with something that may be a little bit friendlier, which is Khovanov homology. So that's what I'm going to try to do. So the idea of the proof here is, well, it's first of all a topological observation, which predates what they did. So actually what I should say is it's really some bounds on the Euler characteristic of embedded surfaces, bounds on complexity of embedded surfaces coming from gauge theory. So sort of the big thing that Kronheimer and Rifka did is very roughly speaking, if you have some piece of an algebraic curve in the four ball bounded by a knot, then that will be minimal complexity among all such surfaces in that homology class. This is what was known as the local Tom conjecture. And what this does is it gives very strong bounds on it gives very, very severe restrictions on, for example, a braid being quasi-positive. Okay, so let me first start with this topological observation, and then I'll say a little bit about how we get these bounds. Okay, so here's the topological observation. Okay, so the point really is that that if you have a braid that's expressed as that's written as a product of conjugates of elementary Artin generators, and they need not all be positive, just if a braid is written as a product of elementary Artin generators, then actually there's a very natural ribbon immersed surface in S3 that is bounded by that braid. And then if you push that into the four ball, you get a ribbon embedded surface. So let me say what I mean here. So the claim is that if beta is written as a product of let's say C conjugates of elementary Artin generators, then its closure bounds a very natural So it's not an embedded surface in S3, but it's immersed in a very nice way, ribbon immersed surface in S3 of Euler characteristic n minus c. Okay, so this is as we know, if we have a braid closure, we can consider sort of the each of the strands. So, let me just draw something a little nicer. If you have a braid closure, let's just do something simple, something like this. Then we have Seifert's algorithm, of course, which gives a Seifert surface for the braid closure, which has n disks, and then if you have c bands, then c bands. So you have this. So then the Euler characteristic of that is just n minus c. And all I'm saying now is that if you now have if you now consider conjugates of these bands, then actually you can apply something like Seifert's algorithm. And you won't get something which is an embedded Seifert surface in S3, but you'll get something which is immersed in a very nice way, ribbon immersed. Okay, so let me remind you what we mean by ribbon immersed. So if you were at Maggie's talk earlier, she said what was meant by that. But the point is that if your surface has self-intersection, well, you can assume by standard innermost circle arguments that it doesn't have any circular intersections. So all the intersections are just arcs. And the arcs can either go, So there are really two possibilities. Basically, one is that a ribbon sort of shoots through some interior of some other part of the surface. This is called a ribbon immersion, or I guess a ribbon singularity. And then the other kind is called a clasp singularity. And these ones we don't like because they're not good at obtaining ribbon embeddings in the four ball, but these we do. Okay. All right. So how do we produce a ribbon immersed surface in S3? So here's a picture of just one quasi-positive band. So this is a conjugate of the elementary Artin generator sigma 2. And what you can see here is that, so you've got this one band here, and all that's really happening otherwise is that, you know, if you think of the four disks corresponding to the four strands of the braid, this disk is just kind of shooting through, and there are immersions here and here. So the fact that really you just have this collection of Reitemeister 2 moves that are locked into place by some band is what's telling you that you have a ribbon immersed surface. And the fact that it has the Euler characteristic that I claimed is just computation. I mean, you just have the original N disks, and then you have these C bands that are locking things into place. And it's just, you've got these ribbon immersions. Okay. And the claim that if you have a Well, the claim that you also have this ribbon embedding into B4 is shown by this movie. So if you have so this is just localized to one of the quasi-positive bands, but now you can do this at each one. So basically, from in going from here to here, all we've done is a saddle move along this arc here. So something that changes this to this. So this is a critical point of index one. And then at that point, everything is just isotopies. So you just undo this Rademeister 1, and then you undo all these Rademeister 2s. Okay. All right. Okay, any questions about that? Okay. All right. So now let me see, what should I? Okay, let me leave this up and come over here. So that, so the second part of the story. So the first thing that we know is that if we have any braid that's expressed as the product of as a product of conjugates of these elementary Artin generators, then somehow that immersed surface is giving us something which is a really good candidate for being minimal complexity in the four ball. Right, so if what we care about is minimal complexity in the four ball, these are really the types of surfaces that we should be looking at, not just the surfaces that we're getting from Seifert's algorithm, but ones that can possibly be ribbon immersed. So what's the second part of the story? Well, the second part of the story is that actually if all of our bands are of the same type, i.e. if they're all positive, then actually some bounds that are coming from gauge theory will tell us that this ribbon immersed surface is actually the best one that we can do in terms of complexity. So the second part of the story is the Slice-Bennekin inequality. And this is really what Kronheimer and Rufka proved. Kronheimer, Rufka, and Lee Rudolph. Okay, so let me state it like this. So if you have a braid with writhe n, and you want to get a bound on this what I mean here is the negative of the maximal Euler characteristic among all surfaces bounded by all oriented surfaces which are oriented compatibly with the braid-like orientation and have no closed components. So this is this sort of minimal complexity among all possible surfaces bounded by the braid. You actually have a lower bound on that coming from just n and w. So negative n plus w.
Writhe w?
Yeah, sorry, thank you. I don't know why I keep doing that. Writhe w. So this, by the way, is if you like contact geometry, this is what's often called the self-linking number of the braid. And it's an invariant of the braid conjugacy class, but it's also an invariant of more than just the conjugacy class. Okay. So now the point here is that if the braid is quasi-positive, so if the braid is quasi-positive, then, well, we actually have a candidate for a surface, and its complexity is will give an upper bound for this. So we have this bound. This is the Slice-Bennikin bound. But then we also have the Euler characteristic of this particular braided surface that we just, this braided ribbon immersed, ribbon embedded surface in B4. And in fact, we know what its Euler characteristic is. It's exactly n minus w. So this negative of the Euler characteristic is exactly negative n plus w. So in particular, what this is telling us is that all of these are equalities, and so this must be minimal complexity. So the braided surface F is minimal complexity. So really, all the hard work somehow—I mean, the topological observation is a very simple one. So the hard work is coming from this lower bound, coming from the Slice-Bennikin inequality. So let's try to understand a little bit in our remaining minutes. About how one might prove some bounds like that. And I'm not going to tell you, I'm not going to go through the definition of Khovanov homology or really any of the, I'm just going to focus on sort of properties because many of these proofs involving homology type invariants actually follow the same formula. So it's actually useful to just kind of know what the structure of these sorts of proofs are. So that's what I'm going to kind of focus on. So you can maybe believe that getting bounds like this is not really all that hard once you understand the machinery. Okay. So here's Slice-Bennikin from Khovanov homology. Okay, so let me tell you at least what type of object Khovanov homology is. So if you have a link in S3, what does Khovanov do? Well, he really actually from a diagram of the link, he constructs an abstract chain complex. And let's say for today, this is going to be over Q. This is just some finitely generated chain complex. Let's say its underlying vector space, graded vector space is C, and its differential is D. Okay. So now this chain complex is not an invariant of the link, but what he proves is that if you take its homology, then it is an invariant of the link. So. So it's the homology of this chain complex. Okay, so this is what Khovanov did. Now, a few years later, E.S. Lee, who's a student of Mrufka's, showed how to construct what she called a deformation of this Khovanov complex. So she constructed a new abstract chain complex with the same underlying vector space, but where the differential was just slightly deformed. So this is, this here, I'm referring to the original Khovanov differential. And so it's really somehow the whole construction was exactly the same, except she just perturbed the differential a little bit. And what she proved is that actually the homology of this this complex is a link invariant. Unfortunately, it's a really boring link invariant. It depends only on the number of components of the link and some classical information. But what was interesting is that this is always isomorphic to 2 to the L copies of your ground field, where L is the number of link components. Okay, so in a certain sense, you could almost think of this as like being the homology of the underlying the Khovanov homology of the underlying 3 manifold, which is S3. So it doesn't really depend on the link at all. So that doesn't sound all that great, but it actually turned out to be really great. Because Jake Rasmussen actually saw that really what Lee had done, so actually something that I was suppressing here is that actually this chain complex has its homological grading, but it also has an extra internal grading. So it actually really splits along some extra grading. So let's say CJ, DJ. And what Rasmussen showed is that Lee's complex, let's call it C Lee, has the structure of a Z filtered complex. So in this particular case, so I'm not going to write down what's meant by Z-filtered complex in general. It's not that it's not that difficult, but I just want to point out that in this case, how you should think of that is that there's this extra internal grading here on the Khovanov complex, and the original Khovanov differential preserves that grading, so the chain complex splits. But in the Lee complex, what happens is that the Lee deformation does not preserve the grading, but at least it's monotonic with respect to it. So the new Lee differential is monotonically increasing with respect to this J grading. So D plus phi is monotonic with respect to the J grading, to this quantum grading, this quantum J grading. And what that means is that somehow a really wonderful thing, because what that tells you is that, so you have this Z-filtered complex, and what that tells you is that it actually induces a grading on on the total homology of the C-filtered complex. So even though the homology is boring, when you take into account the homological gradings, if you take into account the induced grading by this J grading, then that actually carries a lot of information. So you get an induced J grading, what Rasmussen called the S grading, on the Lie homology. And in the case where L is a, this link is actually a knot, he extracts an invariant that he calls the S invariant. And this takes values in even integers. And what's wonderful is that actually it gives the lower bound on the four-ball genus of the knot. This is the four-ball genus. So this is the minimal complexity when you're talking about a single component link, four-ball genus. So somehow secretly what we should really be thinking of here is that actually S minus 1 is less than or equal to G. Oh, sorry, this is twice the four-ball genus. Sorry. Minus 1. So really somehow, and this is the negative Euler characteristic here. So this is really what's going on and really what he proved. Okay. So now how do you get something like the Slice-Benekin inequality out of this? Well, it's actually, you actually just need to do a little bit more work. So this was seen at roughly the same time by Plemeneskaya and Shumakovich. But actually what it turns out is that this S, So I should say, somehow where this bound is coming from is the fact that actually if you have a knot inside of S3 and now you have a cobordism of this knot to the unknot inside of S3. So this cobordism is happening in S3 cross I. This bound is really coming from the fact that actually you now have an induced map on the Lie homology coming from the surface. So let's say psi f from Lie of k to Lie of the unknot. And in fact, the filtered degree of this map, Rasmussen shows, is exactly the Euler characteristic. So somehow these maps behave very well with respect to this filtration, and that's really what's giving us these bounds. Okay, I think I'm really running out of time here. Let me just say how they got this Slice-Benekin bound. Say a little bit about, like, 30 seconds about what I'm thinking about, and then I'll leave it at that. So what Plemeneskaya and Shumakovich showed is that actually this S invariant, just by computation, really, there's not that much that you have to do, but this here is really just a computation of grading. So this S invariant is really the grading of a particular canonical homology class defined by Lie. And by direct computation, you can actually show that you have some representative of that homology class with grading exactly negative n plus w. So this is computation of grading of a particular class, of a particular cycle representing this homology class. This is minus one. And then you combine that with Rasmussen's result to get the Slice-Fennigan inequality. So this right here is the hard work of Rasmussen. Okay, so if your braid is quasi-positive, then the Slice-Fennigan inequality is sharp. In my last negative 30 seconds, so what I'm doing with so joint work in progress with Tony Licata is that actually if you're just looking at braid closures in the solid torus, so if you're just looking at braid conjugacy classes, then actually you can get a whole family of S invariants. So if you're given a braid now not in S3 but in the solid torus, so remember the closure is naturally in the solid torus before you embed it in S3, what you get actually is that this Lee complex has the structure not just of a Z-filtered complex, but actually of a Z plus Z-filtered complex. So what that means is, rather than having a chain complex where the generators sort of sit on a one-dimensional lattice and the differential always maps to the right, you now have a chain complex whose generators sit on a two-dimensional lattice. And where the differentials are always mapping to the upper this quadrant. And why is that great? Well, because if you have such a gadget, then you can sort of project this to any line to get something which is not exactly a Z-filtered complex, but close enough to a Z-filtered complex that you can do this. You can play the same game. So you can Notice if you project, so you know you can always forget about one of the dimensions in order to get an R filtered complex. So forgetting about this sort of vertical, if you project everything to the horizontal line, you still have a Z filtered complex, and also if you project to any line of positive slope, you'll have a filtered complex. And so what we can do is extract a whole family of these S invariants. They're not link invariants, but they're braid conjugacy class invariants, and they potentially give better obstructions to quasi-positivity for essentially the same reason. So I'll stop there.
Yeah. I don't want to dominate over Rasmussen. Mm-hmm. So. I was wondering if you could give some indication of either direction of why the quasi-positive ones correspond to these zero sets of theoretical polynomials.
Oh yeah, right. In my notes I had an example that was supposed to be really, really illustrative, and I realize now that I left it out. If you look at, for example, I think somehow this example at least convinces you that it's plausible, that it's the right thing. So if you look at the example of F equals, this is a very simple example, W squared minus C, and you let Z range on the unit circle. in the complex plane. So of course, when z is 1, so here's cz, and then here are the corresponding points in cw. So when z is 1, well, what are the two roots, just 1 and negative 1? And the point is, as you traverse the unit circle in the positive direction, somehow the positivity is captured over here as well. And indeed, these are sort of rotating half as quickly because they're the square roots. So what happens is, as you go around the unit circle, you take these two and they switch places, but positively. And it's really because of this positivity that is inherent in working in complex geometry. So this is really like somehow you should believe it after you see this. And then the rest is just, a 20-page paper or something. Yeah. Right.
Let's thank Elliot again.